dancing with uncertainty. I kept wondering about this metaphor, dancing with uncertainty. Whether is it a dance macabre, a shamanic dance, or a more structured classical dance? Is there music too? What is the rhythm? Who is leading whom? I have tried to picture the scene with the virus and all established institutions, discourses, narratives, social, economic, and financial order. And it seems for a moment that it is easy to take K to dance, meaning that it was obvious to act against the freedom-based world, right to free movement, free speech, free to choose. The only possibility remained for almost everyone is to stay home in confinement. Nevertheless, the title refers to a movement, a physical activity to change. Would it be possible to dance with certainty? Or certainty is rather of a stable, static nature? Dance into certainty, perhaps? Here I would like to suggest my first theoretical approach or frame in order to broaden our analytical scope to understand the European institutional working mechanisms and to introduce Ilya Prigozhin, who received a Nobel Prize in chemistry for his works, and he lived and worked in Belgium. I would like to highlight here that it is important which theoretical frame we choose to use in order to discover the object processes we analyze. We might end up with different conclusions, or in any case, different interpretation of the so-called real world. Prigozhin fundamentally changed the formulation of thermodynamics by making it a theory of processes, not a theory of state. Things move. In other words, they are not static. According to Prigozhin, determinism loses its explanatory power in the face of irreversibility and instability. Natural processes are all around us and mostly irreversible, and it is a fact. Their consequence is not merely to increase the entropy of the universe and destroy order, they can also do the opposite, create highly ordered complex structures with extraordinary properties and create life itself. So at one and the same time, there is entropy, a gradual decline into disorder, with reordering, the emergence of a new order. Nevertheless, non-equilibrium may be a source of order too. Irreversible processes may lead to a new type of dynamic state of matter, which Prigozhin called dissipative structures. Prigozhin's theory was well received in other sciences, semiotics in particular, and in Yuri Lotman's work. Yuri Lotman used this analogy and wrote a book titled The Unpredictable Workings of Culture, in which explosive processes is one of our interests. Basically, Lotman points to the fact that stasis itself is a dynamic process, where discourses constantly challenge each other at different levels of intensity. Therefore, there is a dynamic relationship between the mainstream and the periphery. Continuing with Lotman's explosion model, that whether COVID can be considered as a trigger, it's too early to tell. Given that the explosion represented by equally plausible possibilities throws chance into the cultural arena. At such a moment, all possibilities are equally plausible, and it is essentially impossible to predict their sequel. This is linked to the fact that explosion itself involves a sphere that was previously situated outside the boundaries of the given culture, which was inaccessible by usual path. The moment of explosion is not only the point at which new possibilities take shape, but also a point at which one becomes conscious of another reality, a moment of dislocation and of the reinterpretation of memory. One must, however, take into account the fact that explosion in depth of culture may be of varying force and may encompass different portions of the cultural sphere. Some will remain local events, leaving their trace in isolated processes, while others will impose their language on an entire age. The latter events possess an especially powerful influence because, as they move from one sphere to another, they are accompanied by incorrect translations. Such explosions force precise concepts to be replaced by metaphors. The question arises, what is happening? Are we now in the process of explosion, or all of those changes can be considered as part of normality? But note here that all that we're familiar with, all those institutions, and not only European, but governmental, sociological, which were created to represent stasis, stability and continuity, determination, eventual equilibrium state, how will they survive? These institutions are based on constitutions, treaties, and the rule of law. Or COVID simply accelerated unnoticed marginal existing processes in order to test the resilience, flexibility, adaptability of these institutions, or simply destroy them? Who is responsible for the continuous workings of change in extraordinary times? Who can decide and on what legal basis? Let me now quote a ringing declaration. Virus cannot defeat democracy. Democracy cannot be suspended in the face of COVID-19. Yes, it was the leading slogan of the President of the European Parliament, David Maria Sassoli, and hence the European Parliament continued its decision-making process online. And this is what the European Parliament says about itself. I think it's important to state it here. I quote, "The European Parliament is the only institution that is subject to universal suffrage, whose decisions have a real impact on Union citizens, and the European Parliament's key functions are to co-legislate with Council, to decide the Union budget, to represent EU citizens, and to scrutinize the work of other Union institutions." Yes, the European Parliament often refers itself as the only democratically elected institution at the EU level. And mainly, when the Parliament is described as an institution, the focus is usually on the MEP's work and the political decision process. At least in Hungary, I'm sure the Libe Committee meetings or the plenary debates are familiar to most of the citizens, given the high and permanent interest in the Hungarian governmental decisions from 2010. Nevertheless, I'm a bit skeptical that EU citizens really do have a deep understanding of the Parliament's activities. In any case, next I focus on the invisible internal governing function of the European Parliament, the role of the Secretary General, the Directorial General System, and the Bureau. We might call this as the deep state, which has guaranteed the continuous workings of the European Parliament during the COVID. And the stress here is on invisible. Of course, the Bureau was not the only governing body. There is also the Conference of Presidents, who are the leaders of the political groups, who are responsible for the political agenda of the Parliament, and also the CCC, the Conference of Committee Chairs. They are responsible for the committee's agenda and defending the committee's competences. From this menu, the competences of the Bureau seem rather technical and administrative. But these are the core structure which guarantees continuity through institutional memory and thought world. I will talk about later thought world in detail. And more importantly, the Bureau's decision affect the entire institutional work, given that all decisions are mandatory for the administration. Think about how institutions work. Institutions create, and this is a quote from Mary Douglas, institutions create shadow places in which nothing can be seen and no question asked. They make other areas show finely discriminated detail, which is closely scrutinized and ordered. So therefore, the Bureau is a designer in terms of administration, the appearance of the Parliament, for example, the buildings, the logo, the communications, internal rules and structures, and also a political and institutional designer, given that through all those decisions, the bureaucracy, the secretariat of different committees conduct their own works, prescribing institutional rules, producing reports and legislation. And this is where things become invisible. In that sense, It is understandable how frustrating it could be for a newly elected MEP facing with all these bureaucratic walls and power constraints while exercising his or her free mandate. Regarding this amount of power, consequently, it is essential for the Bureau to maintain and sustain its own institutional identity. COVID clearly highlighted that during this challenge, the institution was forced to react to the demands of an outsider, a virus, and all of a sudden, the normality of events was hijacked. The most important question immediately arising, who is responsible to take decision and under which procedure or rule? Where is the legitimacy? Where is the power? And yes, the most democratic institution of the EU acted on the president's decisions for a moment. Clearly, a hierarchy at work. No consultation, no discussion, of course. And it was then made to look democratic. Anyhow, the institution swiftly corrected this authoritarian sidestep and the Bureau was involved in the decision-making process. But it had to be assured that everyone is leaning to the same answer and it is always better to produce unanimous decisions. Nevertheless, it might sound odd, but according to Mary Douglas' research, if everybody agrees that the decision is right, it must be wrong. Think about that. One might wonder whether it is a critique of the EU's unanimous decision-making process. Pick your choice. In any case, it means that unanimous judgments are likely to be based on social control rather than on information. Mary Douglas introduces it as a contribution to the sociology of cognition. Therefore, information sharing itself is not enough to create unanimous decision. There has to be a thought collective in operation. Now we come to Ludwig Flack, a Polish later Israeli scientist working in the 1930s. Flack has included science in the socially conditioned product of mankind. A central concept in Flack's work is the Denkkollektiv, which can be translated as thought collective, though Mary Douglas prefers thought world. The Denkkollektiv is a social system, in our case, the governing bodies, the committees, both the administrative and the political side, the MEPs themselves. In its turn, the communication of thoughts necessary for the political, administrative, institutional message that reinforced the Denkkollektiv. In short, institutions do not think, rather they constrain and mold human cognition. And an illustration. It was interesting to listen to a podcast with Manon Aubry, French MEP, who is the chair of the GUE group in the parliament, a far-left group, number one enemy of the right-wing parties, where she was complaining that she has been suffocated by the bureaucracy and now she's acting like more like a bureaucrat than an activist. The internal rules have constrained her political mind in a very real way. But how is it possible that during challenging times, amidst of increasing Euroscepticism, Brexit and several other traumas like the financial, migration and virus crisis, the institutions are able to maintain their integrity? And here is another quote, because institutions perform the same task as theory, they also confer sameness, according to Mary Douglas. Therefore, they have the capacity to introduce filter mechanisms in order to sort out those narrative discourses which are contradictory or at least threatens to weaken the mainstream, the core identity itself. Hence, in the case of the European Parliament, a cordon sanitaire was introduced, meaning that all those who are not represented, the so-called mainstream, for example, the ID or the ECR, those are the far-right and the conservative groups, and mainly in a way Fidesz members too, were simply put into quarantine. And this happened before the virus. The metaphor preceded the real thing, if you like. Consequently, identity and integrity are maintained in one of the governing bodies of the EP in the Bureau, and the Bureau, for now, is operating in a quite comfortable, familiar environment where the only perturbating factor is a pirate. I emphasize here there is no ID and no ECR vice president in the Brewer currently. So the institutional quarantine is lived as irreversible. Otherwise, the stability of the deep state's thought world would be threatened. The EP itself confers identity through its institutional remembering, forgetting, classifying procedures, and screens out the unknown, the disturbing, in our case, the far right and the conservative groups. I would still not call this comfortable situation a thought world based on monism, but the underpinning mechanisms are quite similar. And here we need a bit of Isaiah Berlin to highlight the essence of monism and its advantage. And I quote here, "There is little need to stress the fact that monism and faith in a single criterion has always proved a deep source of satisfaction both to the intellect and to the emotions, whether the standard of judgment derives from the vision of some future perfection." End of quote. And true, during the COVID, the European Parliament tried to send out a single message that all is fine, and indeed it has managed successfully the effects of the pandemic. It went digital. The only multilingual parliament that has resolved the remote voting on essential dossiers, remote participation, and teleworking. Moreover, it was able to offer practical solidarity, for example, charity food production, and to host vulnerable women in need, daily provision of transport for the delivery of food and medical stuff, and even introduced a COVID-19 screening center in its Strasbourg building. The EP identified itself as a role model to other parliaments. However, this success story did not resonate successfully in the member state, and to my best knowledge, no other parliament followed suit. On the contrary, the European Parliament was rather seen as a troublemaker, and the EU as a whole labelled as incompetent and stagnant. Nevertheless, with the simplification of internal complexities of the Parliament's working and the EU decision-making process and competences, a rigid binarism and polarization emerge into the communication sphere. Member states are good, the EU is bad, to put it bluntly. All the various valid political interests and discourses erased, all dynamism was cut off, and highly party-politicized narrative dominate the media and the communication. The polarization and the binarism are, however, deceptive. Here I would like to introduce another semiotician, Algirdas Greimas, to show that how opposite categories, for example, black and white, success, failure, can be multiplied into more categories, and what type of relationships emerge between all those categories or happening. So basically, we see here a semiotic square, which is formed by an initial binary, in our case, success and failure, and the relationship between the two contrary signs is considered to be the assertion, the positive element, and the negative element of the binary pair. The second binary position relationship is the not failure and not success, because failure sometimes doesn't mean success, but doesn't mean that it's not a success and not failure. So here is a complexity of all those hyponym and expressions, and the basic principle of difference brought into play. Every element in the system is defined by its difference from the other element. This semiotic structure, semiotic square, is to underline that polarization indeed conceals dynamism, expels, eradicates varieties of interpretations, meanings, thus sustain simplified explanations, which does not help to understand the workings of the institution. The European Parliament itself showed resilience and adaptability during extraordinary times. How successful it was, there are diverse narratives. In any case, now it reconsiders its own internal rules of procedure. Note that revisions are needed. Some slogans have become visible, some words become empty, and others too full to carry too much meaning. COVID and digital participation challenge a non-virtual democratic EU institution. Indeed, we are in the midst of a dance with uncertainty. And thank you for your attention.